The Gettysburg Gospel, The Lincoln Speech That Nobody Knows, by Gabor Boritt. Narrated by Michael Kramer. Copyright 2006 by Gabor Boritt. This audiobook is published by arrangement with Gabor Boritt and the Elizabeth Kaplan Literary Agency and was produced in the year 2006 by Tantor Media, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Preface. The meaning of the Gettysburg Address has changed generation after generation. It has become one of the nation's most revered texts, even as historians and public figures have used it and puzzled over its meaning. Connotations given to it have twisted and turned. That Lincoln could not have meant all the things attributed to him over the years is clear, nor could the various versions of how he created his great speech all be true. Today, the image of the Gettysburg Address still swings between two extremes. At one end is a persistent tradition that goes back to 1863. It tells of a speech written on the train to Pennsylvania on a piece of wrapping paper retrieved from the floor. Then at the National Cemetery, people received the speech in silence. It had failed utterly, and the president knew it. Ward Hill Lamon, Lincoln's friend and biographer and marshal of the District of Columbia, gave the strongest voice to this tradition, a tale of genius and an uncomprehending public. Many believed what Lamon said. After all, he was at Gettysburg and served as the marshal of the dedication ceremonies. He had introduced the president before he spoke. If anyone knew, he did. The eldest son of the president, who had little use for Lamon, certainly credited him at one time. "My father's Gettysburg Address," Robert Lincoln wrote in 1885, "was jotted down in pencil, in part at least, on his way to the place." The Alabama-born writer Mary Shipman Andrews gave the story its great currency. One day, her son Paul's history teacher, one Walter Burlingame, reminisced in class about his own youth. He told about hearing Edward Everett tell his father, diplomat Anson Burlingame, who also knew Lincoln, that the president wrote his address on a piece of brown paper on the train going up to Gettysburg. Everett, too, had to have known. He gave the main oration at Gettysburg. Young Paul Andrews went home and told his mother, who then wrote a captivating little book, The Perfect Tribute. An interesting provenance, this. Edward Everett tells Anson Burlingame something that is overheard by Walter Burlingame, who tells Paul Andrews, who tells Mary Shipman Andrews, who tells the world. Americans learned this history by heart. For long, The Perfect Tribute reigned as the most popular book on the subject, indeed perhaps on any Lincoln subject. Though Andrews's name is now mostly forgotten, the ideas she popularized still sway no small part of the general public. She admitted in private to taking one liberty in telling the tale. She turned the reputed silence of the Gettysburg crowd into vast reverence, The Perfect Tribute. The little book continues to go through endless editions. Project Gutenberg makes it freely available on the web, and it has been filmed at least twice in 1937 and 1991. That, then, is one end of the Gettysburg Address spectrum. At the other end looms the learned analysis of an extraordinary man of letters, Gary Wills, Lincoln at Gettysburg, The Words That Remade America. If Andrews's speech was written in a few minutes on the train and received with silence at Gettysburg, Wills's was prepared with care and stealthily remade America. If the broad public, the millions who make the pilgrimage to Gettysburg year after year, still hold with Andrews, a good part of the reading public has moved to Wills and made his book a bestseller, also the winner of the Pulitzer Prize. Admiring scholars have taken his ideas further. It is not surprising that the fiction writer, the artist Andrews, for whom a moment of inspiration is all important, sees Lincoln creating his speech in a flash of insight. And the scholarly writer Wills sees Lincoln laboring long and with care. It takes a heroic effort for the students of Lincoln to separate themselves from their subjects. Most of us fail to a smaller or larger degree. Between the two ends of the spectrum, the Gettysburg Address suffers no neglect from writers of history. Yet perhaps since they collected every scrap of the often confusing and contradictory information, and surely there will be more, it has been all too easy to get lost in the tangle. David C. Mearns, one-time chief of the manuscript division at the Library of Congress, a careful student of Lincoln, considered the many dubious recollections about the speech in an essay entitled Unknown at This Address. He then recommended that historians with cleared minds and jaundiced eyes begin again from scratch. This work attempts exactly that. In the process, it grew clear, to cite Mearns again, that some things were just transparently truthful. Some were not. And so a new story emerged. This book tries to clear away the range of meanings later generations laid upon the Gettysburg Address. Kent Graham, author of wonderful prose poetry about the president, wrote that, "If we Americans can't find Lincoln, we are lost." Graham described the address as a transaction between the dead and the living, between the past and the future, from which the speaker has disappeared. These words fit the study of the address itself. The chief purpose of the present work is to let 21st century readers find the speaker and his audience as they were in 1863. The story begins with a picture of Gettysburg after the battle, the site of the greatest man-made disaster in American history. This is where the president came to explain why a bloody war had to go on. These chapters give voice to the dissonance, confusion, and disruption of all that was normal for this town. A glance back at peacetime Gettysburg, in its moments of happiness, is included for contrast. But the book attempts a little more. Gospel suggests spiritual rebirth. When Lincoln's words are best understood, they bring that potential to Americans, indeed to people everywhere. The novelist John Steinbeck recounted his visit with his son to the Lincoln Memorial, and the awed young man blurting out, "Oh, Lord, we had better be great." The final chapter considers how Lincoln's speech rose to be American gospel, the good news, for it was not that at birth. That, too, is quite a story. Gettysburg, July 4th, 1863. Dreadful silence. It rains. People crawl out of their cellars, blinking in the gloomy light, trying to find their neighbors, food, news, life. Strange, awful odors overpower the air and seem to be growing, trying to imprison all in unbearable stench. Dead bodies are scattered over the streets, dead horses and mules. When the oppressive hush breaks, the clatter comes not from rifles or cannon fired to salute Independence Day, but in dead earnest by enemy armies still facing each other at the edge of the town. No toasts are offered today, no fireworks, no parades, no services in churches that are filling up with grievously wounded men. Gettysburg, July 4th, 1863. But Sally Myers, 23, full of life, forges ahead. The sun comes out, and in a free moment she'll write in her diary, "I never spent a happier fourth. It seemed so bright." The Union had retaken the town. A soldier will later add, "The glorious fourth, and we are still a nation, and shall most likely continue to be for centuries to come." Professor Michael Jacobs comes out of his house on Middle Street with his son Henry. So do others. A band marches down Baltimore Street, fife and drum breaking the noxious grip of stillness. People move toward the square. Gabor Boritt, Farm by the Ford, Gettysburg. Chapter 1. After Battle. Gettysburg, July 4th, 1863. Stench fills the air. Excrement from perhaps 180,000 men and more than 70,000 horses has been left behind in the area. There are thousands of flies, millions. Dead men barely covered in shallow graves. 7,000 dead men? More likely close to 10,000. How many dead horses and mules? 3,000? 5? None buried. A nurse writes of carcasses steaming in the sun. The smell of putrid animal flesh mingles with the odor of human decay. It extends into the spirit of the people. War had come to them. Then it had gone and left the horror behind. Gettysburg was a modern progressive small town, though with nearly 2,400 souls as the war started, the census counted it as a city. The houses were brick mostly, spacious fenced yards behind each, with a vegetable garden, perhaps chickens, a cow, a shed, and the privy. The town took pride in its college, the Lutheran Seminary, and all the benefits educational institutions bestowed. It had three weekly newspapers, one Democratic, the Compiler, and two Republicans, the Adams Sentinel and the Star and Banner. They were all highly partisan, but then so were most newspapers throughout the United States. During elections, the area tended to divide evenly between the two parties. Politics provided one of the most important and, at times, all-absorbing cultural activities. Religion provided the other. Gettysburg had 8 churches with 9 congregations, with Lutherans and Presbyterians predominating. It had a new rural burial ground on Cemetery Hill. The schools were public. Pennsylvania required public education, and as one would expect in a college town, Gettysburg had good schools, including 2 private ones for girls and many private instructors. The town had gaslight and some paved sidewalks, but its streets were alternately dusty or muddy. The seat of government for Adams County, it had a beautiful new courthouse built in 1859 close to the central square, the Diamond, as the locals called it. It had new warehouses around a railroad station, also newly built in 1859, right after that modern mode of transportation had arrived in town. Gettysburg was on the move, with lawyers, doctors, merchants, bankers, blacksmiths, and various craftsmen serving the surrounding countryside of small farmers. It had hotels, taverns, and the county prison. Carriage manufacturing thrived with more than 10 shops. There were tanneries. 22 people made shoes and boots. Indeed, half of the population worked as artisans, a quarter as professionals, a quarter as unskilled laborers. The ethnic stock was Scotch-Irish and German, but everyone else also seemed to be represented, including new immigrants, who made up nearly 7% of the town's population. Black people, mostly the poorest part of the community, numbered 190, about 8% of the population. There were professionals and craftsmen among them, and even for the poorest, hope often lived. 1/3 of the black people had escaped from slave states, and freedom meant everything. Basil Biggs, for example, moved his family from Maryland to Gettysburg in 1858 so that his 7 children would have educational opportunities and rented a farm from one of the most prominent members of the community. Biggs farmed and worked as a veterinarian. He must have been very good with animals, and by the end of the war would own his own farm right on Cemetery Ridge, including the copse of trees toward which Robert E. Lee had sent his doomed soldiers on July 3rd. Gettysburg was a modern town, a place of hope for many. But soon the battle came, and for a time making coffins would become an important occupation. So would ferrying bereaved visitors to one of the many makeshift hospitals or the battlefield and digging up the dead. Gettysburg had been transformed into a blighted land and needed to recover in body and soul. July 4, 1863. The rebels are still on the outskirts, but the town is free. Blue-clad troops march in, their bands playing in an attempt to divert soldier and civilian from the horror. It is Independence Day, after all, and the armies are leaving. Life can begin again. But the wounded and dead remain, on the fields, in houses, in barns, and in hospital tents. 21,000 wounded, 10,000 dead. Disinfecting chloride of lime spread over the muddy streets turns them white for a little while and adds to the odors. Snow in July. The townspeople try to extinguish as far as possible the sense of smelling, one woman writes. They try to control disease. They pour kerosene on the bodies of horses and mules, light the fire over them, let them go up in smoke. The smell of burning flesh dissipates after a while. The smell of rotting carcasses will stay around for months. If a carcass is too close to a building or a good tree, it cannot be burned. It must rot. Many days are stiflingly hot, even the nights. To keep the stench out, most people don't open their windows. It is hard to keep the stench from their spirits. Rumors fly. The civilians are dying, too. Sarah Broadhead, a wife, mother, and now nurse to the wounded of the battle, writes in a diary about her fears that we shall be visited with pestilence. Yet among the town's population, there is no increase of disease and death. A resilient people. When strangers approach the town, the odors of the battlefield attack them long before they get there. But the visitors come, many to help, some to gawk, some to plunder, most looking for their lost loved ones from the armies. Masses of strangers. where to put them all. On July 9th, the New York Times reports no accommodations or food here for visitors, and last night many were compelled to roost in the barns or upon the steps of dwellings. A man feels lucky when he gets a chair to sit through the night in front of a hotel, better than wandering till daybreak. On July 13th, the Broadhead's house, in addition to a family of three, has three wounded soldiers and 20 visitors. The strangers are filling every bed and covering the floors. Some complain about the visitors. Too much idle curiosity. Professor Michael Jacobs of the college, however, sees it differently. He wishes the whole land had come. Seeing the blood-stained fields, the sacrifice of the mangled soldiers, and the newly dug graves would rekindle people's patriotism and their gratitude to God for a most signal deliverance at Gettysburg. Many do come and stay in uncomfortable quarters, but their problems shrink in face of the immeasurable suffering of the wounded and the dying. Private George R. Freisinger arrives with an emergency militia unit sent to help maintain order. "We had a severe trial for young soldiers," he writes home to his father. His unit had limped into town on blistered feet and got placed in a church. The sacred structure reminded him of his home, which now felt like a distant Jerusalem to the ancient Jews. "So here we are quartered in a building which it was little thought at the day of its dedication would ever be used to serve the purposes of war. I see the pews occupied by forms moving amid the din and clanging of arms, which the soldiers are brightening up for duty. And instead of singers on the gallery, boys writing letters to their friends far away. Everything remains in the church, seemingly just as the congregation left their last Sabbath's service. Hymn books are scattered through the pews, spittoons and footstools remain in the aisles, and the altar and pulpit carpeted with Brussels. Even the clock hangs suspended, ticking the hours as they fly, and which, instead of meeting the minister's eye, now catches the eye of the sergeant of the guard as he says, 'Fall in, second relief.' Perhaps we will not deface it much, this church," Freisinger writes to his father, adding, "Gettysburg cannot be called a town, but a large collection of hospitals." Eliza Farnham, a volunteer nurse from Philadelphia, tells much the same story. "The whole town is one vast hospital. The road for long distances is in many places strewn with dead horses. The earth in the roads and fields is plowed to a mire by the army wheels and horses, avenues of white tents. But good God, what those quiet-looking tents contained! What spectacles awaited us on the rolling hills around us! It is absolutely inconceivable. Dead and dying and wounded, torn to pieces in every way. Moans, shrieks, weeping, and prayer fill the houses, the barns, the tents, the fields and woods, the whole area. The land itself seems to wail. Nothing but suffering. Sights, sounds, smells unbearable. Horror. The piles of limbs dripping blood. The dying, the dead. Hell on earth." Newspapers that seem loath to report on the horrors admit that the area is one vast hospital. Red and some green flags sprout everywhere identifying places housing the wounded. Nothing like this has ever happened in the United States. Looking back in September 1863, the U.S. Christian Commission would report a scene of horror and desolation which humanity, in all the centuries of its history, has seldom witnessed. The more measured tones of an Army medical officer's report would still be blunt. "The period of 10 days following the Battle of Gettysburg was the occasion of the greatest amount of human suffering known in this nation since its birth, and the government was utterly unprepared for the greatest man-made disaster of American history." Jonathan Letterman, the medical director of the Army of the Potomac, had developed a remarkable system of caring for the wounded. But it was crippled by the commanding generals, first by Fighting Joe Hooker, who, chasing after Lee as he invaded Pennsylvania, did not wish to be encumbered by substantial amounts of medical supplies. This left no system at all, as Letterman would write in an official report that tried to minimize the disaster. Then Hooker's successor, George Gordon Meade, timidly kept much of what remained out of the possible reach of the Confederates, and so also of his own army. This Letterman would liken to engaging in battle without ammunition. Even as the fighting went on, the war-hardened nurse Ellen Orbison Harris of the Philadelphia Ladies' Aid Society understood what was happening. An evident reluctance to forward hospital stores to Hanover or Gettysburg, where a conflict supposed to rage betokens a want of confidence in the position or strength of our forces. Can it be that our soil is to be crimsoned with the blood of our bravest and best? Crimsoned it was, and Dr. Letterman, who obeyed orders, would later write with anger, "Lost supplies can be replenished, but lives lost are gone forever." The U.S. Sanitary Commission, USSC, organized to provide civilian support for the military, sent two supply wagons to Gettysburg on July 4th. One was captured, its personnel sent to prison in Richmond. It would have been impossible to cope fully, even without the bumbling of generals. The able Letterman himself went along when, with victory in hand, Meade followed the retreating Lee and, expecting another major battle, took with him most of the medical corps. "It was absolutely necessary that I should carry away the greater portion of my surgeons and medical supplies," Meade would explain. Close to 21,000 wounded Union and Confederate soldiers remained behind in Gettysburg. "What? Take away surgeons here where 100 are wanted?" exclaimed Andrew Cross, speaking for the U.S. Christian Commission, which focused on both the spiritual and physical needs of the men. But so it is. Even the angry commissioners vastly understated the problem, reporting that there was no more than 1 for 10 of the surgeons needed. In fact, out of the 106 medical officers left behind, perhaps 35 could actually operate. A distraught Ohio Army doctor and ordained minister, Harry Maccabee, who stayed back and had to care with 3 assistants for 1,000 badly wounded men, would resign with bitter words when the crisis passed. "It is my deliberate opinion that the failure to furnish sufficient number of medical officers cost the country more good men than did the charge of any rebel brigade." The official medical report in the fall, however, would state that of the more than 14,000 Union wounded, not one was left on the field on the morning of July 4th. Yet Dr. Letterman was sufficiently aware of the disaster to order the improvement of the system of medical supplies and ambulances. As for Dr. Maccabee, not long after he sent in his protest, an accident would take his life. The Confederate Army might have done even worse. Not only did it have to prepare for another possible battle and also keep medical personnel and ambulances in reserve for those who became ill on the retreat, it did not have sufficient transportation back to Virginia for movable casualties. Lee's medical director, Lafayette Guild, ordered left behind abundant supplies for the wounded and the sick. But that could not be done. In the disaster that followed, the Confederate government and army would take even less note than did the Union side. Nothing would be said about its helpless soldiers drowning by a flooding creek or left lying unattended for days. One of the Gettysburg papers claimed that the rebels left behind them 6 drunken, inefficient, and worthless surgeons and 11,000 wounded. Another local paper bemoaned this inhumanity and poltroonery. But the Sanitary Commission's report described the Confederate doctors as intelligent and attentive, even as it accepted the Army's explanation that impending battle required the removal of most of its surgeons. In short, no neglect was admitted, though Meade took with him more than 4 out of 5 of his doctors. Christian Commission delegates digging graves for the dead reported more boldly, but with masterful understatement, that the Army of the Potomac did not leave a sufficient force to bury the dead, much less to afford necessary attendance upon the mangled and bleeding forms. Union and Confederate, they lie side by side, many without even a straw under them, some with a rail or bottle under their head, half-clothed, destitute and suffering. Many carried fresh from the amputating table. Washington was oblivious. President Lincoln had no idea about what was going on in Gettysburg. His wife Mary had suffered a terrible injury in an accident on the second day of the battle and seemed in danger. She had jumped out of a runaway carriage and received a head wound that grew infected. The private distress of the president was compounded by the inability of Meade to finish off Lee's army. While the rest of the country celebrated a victory at Gettysburg, Lincoln's eyes focused on the retreating Confederate army, hoping to see it annihilated. He thought that defeat of the fleeing Confederates might end the war. The Secretary of War, Edwin Stanton, appeared equally oblivious. He, too, looked to the upcoming days of hoped-for battle. Subordinates who were supposed to handle medical problems didn't understand either. When Nurse Harris of the Ladies' Aid Society went to the War Department on July 3rd to beg permission to bring supplies to Gettysburg, besought the privilege with tears, her pleas were flatly rebuffed. She went anyway. "The Lord will carry me there safely," and only regretted that she obeyed orders about provisions. Nor did the Surgeon General, William A. Hammond, recognize the magnitude of the emergency in Gettysburg. At first, he even refused the offer of civilian help. "How many volunteer surgeons may I send?" Pennsylvania Governor Andrew Curtin asked, and was told, "None." "The medical director of the Army of the Potomac has plenty of surgical aid." General Robert C. Schenck, in command in Baltimore, in turn complained that "barns, houses, and yards are full of the wounded. Pennsylvania is not taking care of them." Eliza Farnham's call for help was published in Philadelphia, but the press remained mostly silent about the horrors. "The army has left Gettysburg," Nurse Farnham wrote, "and we are not here an hour early for the suffering. Please send all that you can." On July 9th, Nurse Harris wrote home about wounded men drowning in flash floods and thousands who were still naked and starving. "God pity us. God pity us." As disaster engulfed Gettysburg, the Philadelphia Inquirer boasted that "our wounded left in Gettysburg are well cared for." But visitors saw, as a woman from Maine wrote, that the newspaper accounts were very different from reality. Men didn't talk much about what was happening all around them. Men need to be strong, need to be men. If you are a wounded, dying soldier in great pain, you try to suppress your cries. Die like a man. If you are a caretaker, you don't often write letters telling about the horror. If you write official reports, you stress the positive. When civilian doctors finally started helping, the medical inspector of the Army would find in late July that the hard work of the citizen surgeons, just like that of the Army doctors, had been performed with fidelity and ability. By October, however, with the emergency passed, Dr. Letterman's final report would blame many, except himself, and revert to the standard Army line, citing the judgment of the head of the General Hospital, which was organized by the end of July to take care of all the patients, that the civilian doctors were of little use. Reverend Henry Bellows, head of the Sanitary Commission, had to work with the government, and so he was charitable, writing to Hammond that the task at hand could not be done by anything short of archangels in prescience and resources. There was some truth to that. To his own people, asking for help, he admitted that "no energy you can use can equal the demand here." Telling the world how badly the system failed was not likely to encourage donations now or in the future. Mrs. Farnham would stand no more than 4 days at the battlefield. Others left quickly, too. Most stayed. Those first days were the worst. A friend would later note how the constant feeling of inability to give adequate relief devastated Farnham. She wrote of a man and his son lying beside him, each having lost a leg. Other men with both legs gone. But the most horrible thing was to see these limbs lying piled up like offal. She left Gettysburg, her friend would testify, and never recovered. For a long time after, she could not sleep. She died 6 months later. Her friend objected indignantly to the death being ascribed to consumption. The cause, but a simple loss of vitality. Doctors worked day and night. "I never saw men work harder and complain less," an Army medical inspector would report. Day and night. Decide who should be looked at first. Leave hopeless cases alone. Lift a body onto the makeshift operating table. Try to stop the soldiers thrashing and howling. Administer anesthesia. Be careful about the right dosage. A nurse would write to her mother, "I saw a man die in half a minute from the effects of chloroform. It seemed almost like deliberate murder." Amputation followed amputation. There was no end to the wounded. Piles of limbs were stacked on the ground under one tree. Surgeons had to be held up while continuing to operate. They fainted from exhaustion. One doctor recorded in his diary getting up at 2 a.m. and working incessantly until midnight. Anxiety is constant, the strain upon both physical and mental faculties unceasing. Some went almost berserk. One witness spoke of the doctor's roughness and brutality that made the blood chill. Language as profane as it was brutal. After the rebels left, the stunned people of Gettysburg shared a sense of terrible isolation. There were no newspapers, the railroad and telegraph were cut. Barricades still stood in the streets, the army blocked all roads in and out of town, and so many of the menfolk were gone. But the disaster around them brought out the best in most people. They got back on their feet, and many devoted themselves to the suffering. At first, the people of the town and the surrounding countryside, especially the women, bore a significant part of helping the wounded. Private homes were filled with the maimed. Churches, warehouses, barns, homes, the seminary and college buildings, all came to house them. Robert G. Harper, the editor of the Adams Sentinel, quartered 50 in his large house on the Diamond, nursed and attended almost exclusively by members of the family. Every bed was filled, and suffering human beings covered every inch of the floors. Harper's wife, Harriet Ann, got to work. She headed up the Ladies' Union Relief Society, which had toiled since 1861 to send the troops food, clothing, and medical supplies, whatever was needed, and sometimes what was not. Men helped, too, but as Fanny Bueller would remember, here was women's work, and they did it nobly. Having assigned such work to the women, the town would in turn provide grateful recognition. The Christian Commission report later went so far as to state that the only hospitals at that time that were properly managed were those in which ladies were engaged. The college building echoed with the groans of the wounded. These were Confederates only. After days of starving, some got a few dried apples. "Never did we see men enjoy a little thing more," came a report. Weeks earlier, President Henry Barker had lost a number of his students to Governor Curtin's call for emergency troops. When the battle arrived, Barker called off classes. The excitement was too much, and in any case, as one of the students recalled long after, the reverend professor told them that they knew nothing about the lesson anyhow. Old Dorm was hit several times during the battle, filled with wounded, and in place of 100 students, 6 or 7 times that number filled the rooms. The students' possessions were all piled into one room and guarded, but books became bloody pillows or served as a place for the dying to record their names and hometowns. During the battle, the professor's own home had held Union wounded and hid an officer from repeated searches. It now held 17 Confederate wounded. July was nearly over before they were removed. The school year would never be completed. In the Barker home, the professor's estimable wife and kind-hearted daughter were singled out for praise, and all over Gettysburg the women worked hard to house and feed not only the wounded but also the caretakers who started coming into town to help. People thought that this was women's work, but what struggle it took to overcome the overwhelming feelings of horror. The initial exposure to the wounded shocked the most. Nurse Emily Souter spoke of her first day as a day of horror, I might almost say, yet a day of blessing. When Sally Myers was called to the Roman Catholic Church-turned-hospital, while the battle still raged, she wrote in her diary that she did not think she could do such work, but I went. She found men lying on pews, the floor, everywhere, the church filled with the pitiful sounds of the suffering. She went up to the first soldier she saw. "What can I do for you?" "Nothing, I am going to die." Sally ran out of the church and cried. But then she went back in. The man, Sergeant Alexander Stewart, died 4 days later in her arms. Sarah Broadhead also kept a diary and said the same. She had to do what I never expected to do or thought I could. When she first saw the wounded at the seminary, she turned away and cried. In the dirt basement of the building that was supposed to teach love, Union soldiers lay in rain-soaked muck. No one seemed to pay attention to them. She went over to one soldier to ask about his wound, and he pointed to his leg. "Such a horrible sight I have never seen, and I hope never to see again. His leg was all covered with worms." The days went on. I am becoming more used to sights of misery. Some soldiers died. It is sad, and even we who have known him so short a time will miss him. Nurse Sophronia Bucklin watched a visiting wife clasping to her bosom a little child of 18 months and sitting for hours with bowed head next to her gut-shot husband, stupefied with morphine. A humane surgeon allowed the drug to ease, Bucklin wrote. The soldier looked up, a wild glare of pain in his eyes. Oh, Mary, are you here? His groans were terrible to hear, and in mercy he was again given the opiate and slept his life out. The compiler later reported on one wife looking for her husband's body, opening 20 graves in vain. Her heart almost failed. Then, in the 21st grave, she found him. But in the hot, humid weather, people feared an epidemic. The newspaper wrote of potions that will destroy the foulest smells. The Army of the Potomac's Provost Marshal, Brigadier General Marzena Patrick, whose job was to keep order, halted exhumations for August and September. Many presumably obeyed, but by then perhaps 1,000 bodies had been removed. Visiting nurse Cornelia Hancock wrote her cousin that there are no words in the English language to express the sufferings I witnessed. The country was very beautiful, rolling, but contrasted to the awful smell of putrefaction. In another letter she told her sister, I shall never feel horrified at anything that may happen to me hereafter. At first Hancock dealt with the horror one way. I have lost my memory almost entirely. But, she added, it is gradually returning. Nurse Emily Souter eased her shock by writing letter after letter to family and friends. The sights and sounds were beyond description, the stench ever present. The amputation table is plainly in view. I never trust myself to look toward it. The groans, the cries, the shrieks. I buried my head in the pillow to shut out the sounds which reached us from a church quite near. The Union soldiers and the rebels lie side by side, friendly as brothers. Monday there was no bread, manna in the desert. Almost every hour has its own experience to tell, from 7 in the morning till 7 in the evening. I am sorry to say that I gave out totally. A perpetual procession of coffins is constantly passing to and fro. It will be a place of pilgrimage for the nation. If this was women's work, men helped too. It was difficult not to, with one's house filled with wounded and dying soldiers. Professor Jacobs would write early the following year about the men in Gettysburg who, like women, would have fainted at the sight of blood and would have started back at the groans of suffering, suddenly finding the strength needed to face the horror. Men, too, helped the helpless. Writing letters to the soldiers' loved ones was one of the most horrendous tasks. Cornelia Hancock would break down doing this chore. Writing to wives, she explained to her cousin, that I cannot do without crying, which is not pleasant to either party. A surgeon said the same. He could take a man's leg off, but when asked, can't you write to my wife and tell her how I died and tell her to kiss Mary? That I cannot do. Nurse Souter managed not to find time for the letters and wrote with regret that many that were alive yesterday are gone today, and several that we saw today, I fear we shall see no more forever. In the midst of the horror, Robert Harper published a long letter from a Missouri minister and Gettysburg native trying to give meaning to the bloodletting. The letter voiced thoughts growing all over the North. To those who called for the direst punishment on the enemy, no, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. At the heart of the conflict, slavery. It is the mortal antagonist of democratic institutions. The deadly war that is now waging is, on the one hand, the price we are paying for past and present complicity with iniquity. On the other, it is the cost of a higher, purer, nobler national life and character, the realization of the grand idea enunciated in the Declaration of Independence. God forbid that the war should stop short of this glorious end. Some months later, the people of Gettysburg would hear some of the same thoughts voiced, more beautifully, by the President of the United States. and then in 1865 they would read them in his second inaugural address. Nurse Ellen Harris was one of the many nurses, clergymen, and eventually doctors who thronged to Gettysburg to help. With the government unable to cope, private individuals and organizations stepped in. The U.S. Sanitary Commission was first on the scene and played a central role in the rescue efforts. "Uncle Sam is very rich but very slow," Nurse Hancock mused. "If it was not for the sanitary, much suffering would ensue." The Sanitary Commission made so much of a difference that appalling Gettysburg summer. During the later 1850s, Americans had heard the many tales of neglect in the Crimean War, and they wanted better for their own. As Strong Mary Livermore, wife of a Chicago editor and an important leader of the USSC, would later say, women refused to release their hold on the men of their households even when the government had organized them into an army. At first regarded by some in the War Department as well-meaning but silly women, led by weak enthusiasts, bumbling males, the Sanitary Commission came to play a large role in the war, helping the government to care for sick and wounded soldiers. Established in the major cities and towns of the North by reformers, leading clergymen, businessmen, and civic leaders, the USSC aimed to improve society and brought men and women into close working relations. It organized thousands of relief groups and employed hundreds of paid agents. It combined charity with the desire to return the men to their units rapidly. It counseled control of individual attachments and each soldier's body. The sanitary also served as an army watchdog for camps, hospitals, even kitchens, and demanded sensible waste disposal, clean drinking water, and proper drainage. It held fairs and raised millions of dollars, mostly for medical supplies, but when needed for food as well. And these were badly needed in the July heat and stench of Gettysburg. Its workers, the angels of the battlefield, mostly middle and upper-class women, created a nurturing world. And over it, Nurse Georgiana Woolsey mused, we women rather reigned. Below them were the many women from all walks of life, some black, who worked for pay doing the bulk of the chores, cleaning, cooking, laundry, and more. They would not write letters about their experiences in Gettysburg, would not write memoirs, or if they did, the future swallowed them. The first wagons of the Sanitary Commission arrived on July 6th. A day later, rail communication was restored by an ingenious former Gettysburg College professor, Herman Haupt, but with a temporary terminal a mile east of town. Refrigerating cars which had been converted to movable ice houses, brought tons of ice, mutton, poultry, fish, vegetables, soft bread, eggs, butter. Not only the necessities, but luxuries. Delicate food. Provisions were badly needed. Lee's army had taken everything, leaving the area almost entirely destitute. One newspaper added, this region is eat out. The USSC also sent clothing, furniture for the hospitals, and more. After the initial shortages, many of the wounded would receive better food than most of them ever had in their whole lives. As one medical director told the nurses, clean avenues and clean tents would not cure a man. There is nothing better. Feed them. I say feed them. The men were in charge, and at times the women chafed. They wanted the doctors out of the way, but relations between men and women worked, even as the women reached for ever larger roles. Eventually, the army sent supplies, and coffins too, but the private groups continued to play a major role. The sanitary's co-worker and rival, the Christian Commission, pooled the efforts of the churches and contributed food and other necessities. The Sanitary Commission's Reverend Bellows could not but commend the enterprise, zeal, and blessedness of the labors of this sister institution. In private, however, Sanitary Treasurer George Templeton Strong characterized Christian Commission members as an ugly-looking set. Some were unctuous to behold, the others vinegary, a bad lot. They seemed to him one of the many forms in which the shallowness, fussiness, and humbug of our popular religionism are constantly embodying themselves. The excellent connection the Christian Commission now developed with the press seemed to bother its rival. From this source we have realized considerable advantage, the organization noted. In fact, the USCC quickly brought much-needed material help to Gettysburg, even if its chief concern remained the spiritual needs of the men to fight the dark side. It conducted prayer meetings and provided Bibles, hymnals, prayer books, temperance and religious tracts, books and newspapers, religious or otherwise. Of the good that has been done, eternity will disclose the account, its report would conclude. The Commission's delegates believed that they were finding mostly receptive wounded, including quite a number of true Christian men who gave evidence of their having been born again. Believers indeed could find their last moments in the light. One delegate wrote that it is impossible to describe the beam of glory on the face of a saved dying man, unearthly and beautiful beyond all. The soldier pointed to heaven as though he would have contrasted here and there. The townspeople felt that both commissions, sanitary and Christian, were doing a noble work here. Whoever aids them, Sarah Broadhead wrote in her diary, was doing the noblest work on earth and will be amply rewarded even here, not to mention the hereafter. Adding to the efforts of these large relief organizations, the Catholic Daughters of Charity came from a convent in nearby Emmitsburg. In their medieval dress, the sisters brought hope and created doubt about anti-Catholic prejudices. Some of them worked at the Lutheran seminary that now served as a hospital. Blessed, pure, angelic women, noble-hearted and self-sacrificing, the compiler described them. The Patriot Daughters of Lancaster came too. So did a Baltimore Fire Department, the Adams Express Company of that city, some state delegations, and numerous other groups and individuals. But Gettysburg was the greatest man-made disaster in American history, and the reality was that the town, the country, the North, at first had a very difficult time coping. The Confederate soldiers fared the worst. Lee had left behind his most badly wounded men, and when help came to the battlefield, it went first to the soldiers of the Union. When Reverend Bellows arrived, he walked into a barn unwillingly neglected, filled with rebel wounded. He found every foot occupied by wretched men. Those above in the barn might almost be said to be in heaven, as compared to those below in the stable, who might with equal truth be said to be in hell. For upon heaps of dung, reeking with rain and tormented with vermin, the wounds still undressed lay fair and noble youth. In emergency, medical or otherwise, the Union soldiers got help first. When the floods came in early July, the mean little creek got mad and rose 7 feet. In a mad scramble, men waded into the waters, pulling out several hundred wounded and dying men, the rain falling in torrents all the time. "How I did work," wrote one hospital steward to his wife. "How the poor fellows did suffer." Later, the official report of the surgeon in charge would register in carefully chosen words that none of our men were swept down the creek and drowned. Rebs were not mentioned. Men can only do what they can do. A disgusted Union colonel fumed when Confederate wounded were ignored. "I fear I should be very hard on such fellows who refuse to help." Still, before long, the Rebs, too, were collected and given more or less equal care, if not equal moral support. Whatever horrors might await them as prisoners, the caregivers instinctively gave the Southern wounded their best. One young rebel officer had a face innocent enough for one of our New England boys. "I could not think of him as a rebel," wrote Nurse Woolsey. "He was too near to heaven for that." "We are rebels, you know, ma'am," said another. "Do you always treat rebels so?" They generally did, except in a few instances, one of the first historians of the battle, Professor Michael Jacobs, would write. In some cases, the imprudent zeal of sympathizers transcended the bounds of propriety and decency. One visitor overheard rebel officers half complaining that the gentle treatment will perfectly subjugate us. It will bind us together. A visitor from New Hampshire who came to retrieve a body marveled that among the wounded there seemed to be no feeling of hatred or spite. He quoted the words of his dead soldier friend, borrowed from the Reverend Henry Ward Beecher. One should pray for the soul of a rebel at whom he was aiming his unerring rifle. The long-ago message of St. Augustine lived. Helping the wounded Rebs? Gospel rules command us. But people complained about the terrible extra burden put on them by the Confederates, who had just plundered the region and had left thousands of casualties behind. The women caring for them had to let off some steam. Nurse Hancock felt relieved that, "I have one tent of Johnny's in my ward, but I am not obliged to give them anything but whiskey." Nurse Broadhead was happy she could write in her diary, "This day has been spent in caring for our men." And Nurse Souter noted, "I felt I could hardly wait upon the rebels. I have seen as many rebels as I care to see for the rest of my life." Sometimes the rebs were dubbed white trash. People were conflicted about helping the enemy. The town had seen nearly 5,000 prisoners herded through on their way to prison. Official policy was to make no distinctions toward the wounded, but revulsion for traitors, hatred for robbers and killers, called for one thing, charity for another. The Christian Commission felt the need to provide a whole litany of reasons why its original purpose of aiding the soldiers of the Union had to be changed and extended to the rebels, too. A member of the Sanitary Commission also had to explain why supplies collected at home would be given to Confederates. They got equal treatment when it came to food, but clothes only went to our own men, except now and then when a shivering rebel needed it. With the Patriot Daughters of Lancaster, on the other hand, clothing went first to the Union soldiers and then to the enemy. One could sense among the medical workers the disgust and horror felt for rebels, giving place to the kindest feeling for wounded men. Rebs would report that in hospital tents, Confederate and Yankee are often promiscuously thrown together. At the Sanitary Commission's supply house in the center of Gettysburg, doctors waited for their turn to get supplies, regardless which side they belonged to. After a general hospital was established west of town, a cemetery went in next to it, and a man from Massachusetts would be buried next to another from Virginia. Indeed, one of the most remarkable faces of Gettysburg is the charity it showed to the enemy. If many died, others were nursed back to health. But then, every so often, news like this came to the people of the town. 60 or 70 rebel officers and men were sent off yesterday. Their future destination we know not. In fact, a steady stream of the wounded, train after train after train, took the Confederates to prison hospitals along the eastern seaboard. Nor would charity go so far as to provide places for the Confederate dead when the National Cemetery was created. Clergymen ministered equally to both sides, but that too could be a mixed blessing. If you were Catholic or Jewish, or perchance a non-believer, all too often you still got a Protestant minister. One Reb, with the unforgettable name of Decimus et Ultimus Barziza, the last of 10 children, would long remember sanctimonious New England preachers coming into his room at the college and, after sighing and wheezing and sucking their breath, condescendingly give a poor rebel a tract and a cracker. But a Christian Commission delegate found among the rebels 4 professing Christians to 1 such Federal, though not all agreed. A visiting pastor recounted telling a soldier, "I was a minister and came to point him to the Lamb of God who taketh away the sins of the world," and the dying man refused to let go of him. The scene was common, a soldier, Union or Confederate, crying, "O Jesus, Jesus, help me," a minister kneeling and praying, joined by women singing a hymn, "Alas, and did my Savior bleed," and the chorus, "O Lord, remember me." Then there was the rebel lieutenant who wrote in his diary about a Sanitary Commission minister. "Morning, day, and night he comes and prays, alike for friends and enemies." One day he bursts in with the glorious, if erroneous, news of Lee's defeat and capture. Rebels remind him who the minister is talking to, whereupon the hapless man exclaims, "Excuse me, boys, excuse me. Really, I thought you were our boys." Union and Confederate soldiers lying side by side, quite friendly, as Nurse Souter noted, friendly as brothers, suffering together, treated equally, made for reconciliation. The future looked brighter. But being together could also be a cross to many. Though the attempt was made to avoid political discussion, serious talk did occur, with less than happy results. Nurse Harris claimed that rebel officers all admit that the war was about slavery. To her astonishment, a Confederate chaplain, an intelligent Christian man, justified the war, saying, The preservation of slavery, one of God's wisest and most beneficial plans for Christianizing the African race, demanded and deserves all the blood and treasure given to its defense. "Is it not wonderful?" she exclaimed. Secesh ladies from Baltimore were allowed to come and take special care of the Confederate wounded. In a few cases, they smuggled in civilian clothing and helped soldiers to escape. So restrictions were put in place, but not enforced with great care. After one of these young nurses, Effie Goldsboro, went back home to Baltimore, her sister would recall, "We did not know her at first. She returned to us the most dilapidated young girl that tongue or pen could describe." Another woman would write of shrieks, cries, and groans, the amputating tables, those ghastly bleeding limbs. "Never will those scenes of suffering pass away." And she added, "Would that we could forget them. In our working hours they are constantly before us, and they haunt us yet in our dreams." Gettysburg's gruesome work went on. But if it sometimes seemed unbearable, the work could be both liberating and fulfilling. Weak women grew strong. Strong women grew stronger. Cornelia Hancock wrote to her sister, "There is all in getting to do what you want to do, and I am doing that." She told her mother, "It seems to me as if all my past life was a myth. I feel like a new person, eat onions, potatoes, cucumbers, anything that comes up, and walk as straight as a soldier, feel life and vigor which you well know I never felt at home." The women thought their service equaled that of the soldiers. At summer's end, their great adventure also ended. Sophronia Buckland would muse, "All were gone. My occupation was gone. The strain of months was suddenly let go, and I found how much the strength of my hands depended on keeping them steadily employed." In well-to-do homes, black women servants helped with the huge burdens. They cooked, washed, and provided care and company. Exhausted physically and emotionally, all soldiered on, white and black. When at last most of the wounded were gone, or dead, then the women would have time to recover. One woman would remember decades later, "For weeks I wanted to do nothing but sleep." As the care of the wounded continued to improve, the town tried to resume its normal life. But the shadow of the battle was not easy to escape. Nurse Woolsey reported that children played war games. The streets of Gettysburg were filled with the battle. People thought and talked of nothing else. Some settled political scores. The Democratic proprietors of the Globe Inn were dragged before Provost Marshal Marzena Patrick for aiding the enemy. The editor of the Democratic paper, The Compiler, Henry Stalla, was arrested and sent to Fort McHenry. He was released, sent back, released again. His paper, according to the Republican Sentinel, had long been regarded by unconditional Unionists as being of very doubtful loyalty. Charges were dismissed. Stalla expressed great indignation at these political machinations, but some of his opponents thought he should have been hanged on the spot. The national press continued to talk about copperheads in the area, Democrats deemed disloyal and tarred with the name of a poisonous snake. Partisanship thrived. Josephine Forney, a Gettysburg native who married a Virginian and lived in that state, noted in her diary that those who were not true Union people here have a heavy burden to bear. But toward the wounded, defeated rebels, the local people held much less bitterness or rancor than one might expect. Caring stories about the Confederate dead appeared even in the Republican press. One report in the Sentinel described two locks of hair found on a dead soldier from Louisiana.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.